Winifred Doreen Hinkson of Orange Grove, St. Joseph, entered peacefully into rest on Wednesday, July 19, 2023, at age 76. Daughter of the late Carmen Bridgman and Wesley Marshall, mother of Heather Hinkson and Sherry Mayhee, grandmother of Zuri Gaskin, Angel Anderson, and Rihanna Maxwell, great-grandmother of Kalani and Lilani Maxwell, sister of Joyce and Anderson Hinkson, Paul Bridgman, Euthaline Holder, Kathleen and Cynthia Franklin, Elsie Beckles, Hazel Gaskin, and the late Orville, Pearl and Nigel Hinkson, aunt of Matthew, Carrie Joy, Anderson Jr., and Davin Hinkson, Leanne Barrett, Nikos and Richard Boxall, Paula Bridgman, Nathan Weeks, Hyacinth Clark, Joanne Lovell, Inga Phillips Green, Brian Johnson, and aunt of many in the Marshall, Holder, Franklin and Green families, mother-in-law of Robert Mayhee, sister-in-law of Denise and Valletta Hinkson. The funeral of the late Winifred Doreen Hinkson leaves Earl's Funeral Home on Wednesday, August 9, 2023, for the St. Augustine's Church, St. George, where relatives and friends are asked to meet for the service of Thanksgiving at 2 p.m. The funeral will then proceed to St. Joseph Church Cemetery for the interment. Live streaming of the funeral may be viewed via watch.earlsfuneralhome.com/Winifred Hinkson.
Thank you. Congregation, please stand. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and I am the life. He who believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His compassion never fails. Every morning they are renewed. Jesus said, let not your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. If we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. We brought nothing into the world, and we take nothing out. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. The eternal God is our refuge, and underneath are the everlasting arms. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal, have mercy upon us.
Please be seated while the deceased is eulogized.
Church. My name is Sarah, and I'm going to say the eulogy on behalf of the family. How do you reflect a time in a few moments, and in those few moments, how can you adequately portray the essence and embodiment of that person, especially the one I am so very blessed to call mommy? I was about 5 years old when I met a beautiful lady. It would make sense that I had seen her many times before. My Uncle John would bring me to see. At that age, I didn't understand much, but there was one thing I knew for sure. I knew that everything felt right when I was with her, and I knew the emptiness, sadness, and loneliness when she was gone. The longing to be with her in her presence was overwhelming. Her impact was profound. I also remember the day I suddenly understood. This was the missing piece. This was my mummy. What was it about this lady that impacted me so powerfully that from that moment of realization, I had only one desire, to be with her, to hold her hand and never let her go, to never say goodbye. Through tantrums and tears, crying myself to sleep at night, wondering when I would see her again. The paradox of life. At 52, sitting at her bedside day and night, holding her hand, knowing one day soon I was going to have to let go. I am that 5 year old again. This time, I didn't ask her every 5 minutes if she loved me. And that wasn't because I didn't feel loved by her, but because of the pure joy, peace, and security I felt hearing her say patiently every time, yes, I love you. This time, I asked myself if my love had been enough. if I had done enough that she could felt that same pure joy, peace, and security, knowing that she was so deeply loved. It was wanting to say the words. We always said the words. It's another to have the revelation. So what was so special about this lady called Winnie? Everyone who took the time to get close knew. She was gentle, meek, and mild, contented and peaceful, humble. And I have never heard my mother shout. I have never heard her speak ill of others, never in disagreement or in other people's drama. I have never known her to be a gossip or be involved in anything that went against the grain of peace. Quiet and soft-spoken, never had too much to say. Unlike me, whom she would gently chest and say, "You talk too much." All who knew her would always say, even now, always smiling. You can never forget her smile. Mommy's smile was special. It was imanted from her heart. It shone like a piece from a place of purity, goodwill, and peace. It transformed time and space. Considering all my mom endured, her ability to smile and be gracious where others might have become bitter by the same measure of life was truly a special gift. Mommy was determined and resilient and with untold fortitude, demonstrated throughout her life to the very end. Since her passing, people have resonated these things above. Winnie was always so contented and peaceful. Nothing was too good that she couldn't give it to someone or share. Never fuss or fight. As a young woman, I believe to validate myself, there needed to be tangible evidence of accomplishment, professional titles, accreditations and accolades, things that linked to economic development and the physical evidence manifested through those accomplishments, and then my own revelation. Everything I was running from was everything I needed to run to. Everything my mother represented, her qualities and the soundness of her character, her integrity like a diamond, tried and true, was the best and only validation that counted, the only validation one should seek in this life. This is the rock upon which the wise man builds and the foundation on which everything else can be realized. This was her most precious gift to me, to her children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. Mommy did not speak. She demonstrated. She modeled a life and charted a path, leaving the greatest legacy of all times. Mommy faced so many storms in her life, but she faced each suffering in silent resilience without murmur or complaint. How I wish everyone could see her strength, that everyone could see the unassuming, often overlooked, but most precious gem of all. My mommy loved and cherished her family, her brothers and sisters she held in great esteem. I will not provoke jealousy by stating a favorite, Uncle Orville. But she had a special relationship with them all, and most especially Uncle John. Often, if met with resistance, I'll say, "I'm going to call Uncle John," to which I would get her trademark stoops and a murmur. "Well, go call him then." Ironically, full compliance would follow, but without a smile, at least not for some time. Uncle John's name is one she would often call, perhaps because he really was her favorite, or perhaps because of the pizza and ice cream and treats that would manifest each visit. Only Mommy would know. I did see the genuine love, affection, and sibling banter that ensured each time, and knew that when no one could make her budge, he could. Our last indication in March this year was that all was well with no sign of illness. In May, we were told it manifested to the brain, and on July 19th, 2023, she transitioned. Mommy passed away 2 years to the date I first got the call from Aunt Val. We believe in no one knowing the day and time was based on what we did know, and that she would have been with us for years longer. No one is ever prepared. I definitely was not, but I am very thankful that my family and I could be here for these last 2 years to be with her, help her, and carry her through this journey. Mommy leaves behind 2 daughters, Sherry, her eldest, and Heather. 3 grandchildren, Rihanna and Angel, and 2 great-grandchildren, Kelani and Liani, brothers John and Paul, sisters Joyce, Etheline, Kathleen, Cynthia, Elsa, and Hazel, many nieces, nephews, cousins, and extended family. As she was in life, so was her passing. She sipped away at home without fuss, eyes closed, holding my hand with her children, grandchildren, and their 2 dear friends at her side. With contentment, peaceful, and so very gentle, Mommy took her last sip of life. I have had to let your hand go, but we will hold you forever in our hearts, just as you, as I know you hold us. To be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord, safe and sound in the arms of Jesus. I told God and I told you, if there's a choice in life about who our mothers could be, it will always be you, Mommy. I choose you.
We now have solo MOR praise and worship. Thank you. the hope in him. The hymn, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name.
be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we remember before you today your servant Winifred Doreen. And we pray that having opened to her the gates of larger life, you will receive her more and more into your joyful service. That with all who have served you in the past, she may share in the eternal victory of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
Please be seated while we all have the first scripture reading.
A reading from the Word of God, written in the book of Romans, chapter 8, beginning to read at the 20th verse. We know that all things work together for good, for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn within a large family. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then are we to say about these things? If God is for us, who is against us? He who did not withhold his own Son, but gave him up for all of us, will he not with him also give us everything else? Who will bring anything charged against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? It is Christ Jesus. Who died? Yes. Who was raised? Who is at the right hand of God? Who indeed intercedes for us? Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword, as it is written? For your sake, we are being killed all day long. We are counted as sheep to be slaughtered. No, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am convinced that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor death, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Here ends the first reading.
The Psalm number 42, the 42nd Psalm.
With
for the help of his countenance. My God, my soul is vexed within me, therefore will I remember thee according to the land of Jordan and the
Please be seated while we have the second scripture reading.
Scripture reading is taken from John chapter 16, verses 1 through to 6. Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way ye know. Thomas saith unto him, Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way? Jesus saith unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto me, unto the Father, but by me. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The hymn, All Creatures of Our God and King.
Amen.
Oh, praise Him.
us pray. May the words of my mouth, the meditation of all our hearts, be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer.
Amen.
Please be seated. Some words taken from Romans chapter 8 and verse 28. We know, in fact, that God works all things together for good with those who love him, who are called according to his purpose. We know, in fact, that God works all things together for good with those who love him, who are called according to his purpose. I am sure that most of you are not familiar with that particular translation of Romans 8 and 28. In fact, for most of us, when we come to this particular text, we take from it the wonderful assurance that God, recognizing that not everything and not all circumstances in this life are for our good. My brothers and sisters, the lament that we heard chanted in Psalm 42 is very real. The lament that Paul would have addressed in Romans 8 and 36, where he's taught about persons being accounted as sheep for slaughter, we are well aware. The family who gathered this afternoon to once again lay to rest a mother, an aunt, cousin, a well-loved member. They are well acquainted that sorrow, grief, pain is very much a reality of human existence. Yet we are assured that amidst all of that, God's purpose will prevail. And that, my brothers and sisters, is a wonderful assurance. It can help persons who this day may be struggling to recognize that despite the sufferings we go through, all the ups and the downs of this life, eventually, God's will be done. As the group this morning who gathered for our Wednesday service would have heard, in the last day, our God will say, "It is done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, and he will bring all goodness to fruition." Yet we must not forget that Paul wrote that particular verse in the context of a larger chapter. Paul, in writing that verse, was writing about the prayer life of the Christian in response to the darkness of this world. You see, many of us treat prayer as though it was a candy dish. You know, you go and you take what you want and you pluck it out. Or some of us treat it like an ATM. You go to it and you try to withdraw as much good things as you can. We treat our prayer life, in other words, as a wishing well. Heavenly Father, I want da 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 da. Heavenly Father, I do not want da 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 da. But my brothers and sisters, prayer is much more than that. Prayer is much more than the words that we utter. Henry Nguyen, a Christian spiritual writer, once said that, "Do not think of prayer simply as thinking about God. Rather, see it as a means of how to think and live in the presence of Almighty God." Think back to our sister Winifred's life. As her daughter wonderfully said, she was one who was peaceful and a peacemaker. And as I heard the attributes they described, I had to smile to myself because our sister Winifred is the exact opposite of me. I have never been described as being quiet. I have never been described as one who is peaceful. And that, my brothers and sisters, comes from somewhere. We don't just pop up with certain attributes. We know that, right? God gives us and works through us certain attributes so that when persons encounter one who is the exact opposite of them, if you're smart, you pause and you reflect, what is it? And how is it that this person can be so peaceful and calm despite all the things of life? How is it that she could remain so calm when I am here ranting and raving? What does she know that I don't know? How has she been touched and blessed in a way that I have not allowed myself to be touched and blessed? You see, our prayer lives, my brothers and sisters, are meant to draw us into that deeper and nearer presence of Almighty God, as near as we can get on this side of the Jordan. But how do we treat to our prayer lives? Paul, here writing in Romans 8 and 28, was seeking or hoping that the hearers of his message would imbue their prayer life with such godly presence that even when they do not know what to say, the Spirit of God that rests in them will groan on their behalf, will lift all things up to Almighty God. That those persons whose prayer lives are the reflection of being a present of God will wrestle, yes, with the pains and the sorrows, because I am not encouraging anyone this evening to be la-di-da in life. The members of St. Augustine know that I am very weary of persons who say that they never suffer, they're never sad, they're always happy. If you're always happy, I can ask you, where you on? What you had this morning? There's a moment for sadness. There's a moment for sorrow. There is a moment for deep questioning of Almighty God. And God asks us to do that, to bring it to him, to wrestle with the pains and the sorrows, but do not do so alone. Groan as all creation groans in longing for the presence of Almighty God. This is what St. Paul writes to us. But do so in such a way that we can then turn those sorrows and that pain and that wrestling into working with God for good. How many of us can say that that's what our prayer life is like? That when we wrestle with the sorrows and the pains of this day, we seek to turn it into something that is beneficial for someone else. For the family who mourn yet again, our sister Pearl was a few months ago, and now our sister Winifred. How can that reality be turned into something beneficial? How can we wrestle with the pains not to become hopeless, not to have a shallow faith, but so that we in turn can bless others and be a blessing for others? Have we ever considered that? Have we ever considered allowing God to use us in the midst of our pains to be an honest reflection of life? How many Christians believe that once they become saved and sanctified, all things will go well? And then when things do not go well, they got to start rationalizing. We have not been promised, my brothers and sisters, all things go well. We have been promised that even in the midst, God is there. That even when we cannot articulate our sorrow, he is there. When we do not even know what to ask, the Spirit within us has already lifted up our concerns to Almighty God. And more than just lifting it up, will provide us a sense of consolation and comfort. Elsewhere in Scripture, we are told that as we have received comfort and consolation from Almighty God, we are meant to in turn offer comfort to others. How many of us seek to do that? How many of us who claim to be Christians, who claim to follow in the faith that our sister would have had throughout her entire life, A faith allowed her, even in the midst of illness, to remain peaceful and joyful. How many of us allow ourselves to be used as light and hope to others? We had the trio earlier sing the song, Till We Meet Again. And one of the lines goes, until we meet again, how'd it go? May God give you strength. So who is singing there? It can't be us to the dead. Because the dead don't need strength anymore. They no longer suffer. Our sister Winifred suffers no more. She's in pain no more. So who needs to hear that they need the strength of Almighty God to see the days ahead until we meet again? Until we walk those golden streets. Who needs to hear that? Is that not you and I? Is it not you and I who remain here? Who need to be reminded that we need the strength of Almighty God until we meet our beloved again? That we need to have such a prayer life that we are counted among those who God can use in working his purpose out. I often say to persons, when we pray to God to remove from our lives the sources of stress and strain, people who will tear down rather than build up, remember somebody's praying about you too in them same words. What do I mean? When we do not allow ourselves to be used for God's goodness, when we do not allow our pains to be transformed into something that is beneficial, but we become hardened. And we know such persons, right? That they go through the pains and suffering of this world and they become hard. They become mean. They are no longer useful for God's purpose. And then we have to pray that, Lord, help me to deal with Reverend Yolanda. She's miserable and kind, tankers, but Lord, have mercy. I got to go see her right now. So Father, pray, cover me with your presence as I go with her. This time, Reverend Yolanda praying, Father, cover me with the presence of your presence because I have to go and deal with these provisions. But why are we praying like this? Because we're not praying aright. We are not praying as St. Paul would have us pray. St. Paul says to us in Romans, God is for us. Who then can be against us? God's love is as such that not even death can separate us from his love. And so therefore, even as we mourn the loss of our mother, our sister, our aunt, or friend, we do not need to become hardened. We can remain hopeful. Yes, we mourn. Yes, we have questions. Why is it that we do not have any more time with our sister Winifred? Why is it that she who was so good, so peaceful, has been taken from us? And quite frankly, there are some people walking around here that, Lord, you know. You know. But Almighty God, I trust in you. Heavenly Father, I do not understand. My heart burns, but I trust you. I lean on you. Give me your strength. Help me to see these days where I may turn my pain into something fruitful, where my questions can help someone else, where I may indeed stand firm and faithful so I can see my mom, my sister, granny, auntie, my good friend, one more time. My brothers and sisters, I pray Let us use our sorrows in a beneficial way. Let us be honest with each other in the midst of our mourning. Let us not pretend as though we are not hurting. Let us rely on one another. Let us allow others to help us. You know, that is the hardest thing for some of us, right? To allow ourselves to be vulnerable before others. St. Paul said to us, God will work all these things out with those, you and I, who commit ourselves, who mold ourselves, who bend ourselves to his will, and who go before him as all creation does, praising him, but also seeking his strength and his solace. Will the days ahead be easy? Of course not. Because we seek to follow God, does that mean that it will be automatically all sunshine? No. But what I can assure you, family, is this. If you continue to trust in Almighty God, if you seek to develop a prayer life that is a life of living in the presence of Almighty God, you will become stronger. You as a family will knit together tighter bonds to help each and every one of you see the days ahead. You will remember our sister Winifred with joy, but also with hope that one day, with God's grace and God's mercy, when we are all gathered up together in his presence, we will stay in his nearer presence and enjoy that everlasting and blissful life. And that is why we can sing, till we meet again. May we remember we rely upon God's strength. We rely upon God's presence. Let us pray. Gracious Father, may you help your children this day develop such lives of prayer that we seek to draw ever closer to you. May nothing stand between us and you, not even our sorrow. May our pains be brought before you and healed by you. May we trust in your gracious love that our sister Winifred may be enveloped by your loving presence, that she may enjoy eternal life with you. And may we do all in our lifetimes, following in her good example and the example of our Lord Jesus Christ, so that we too may come to rest in your presence and eternal, come to celebrate and live eternal life. We ask all this in none other than the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Redeemer. Amen. Let us all now stand, reflecting upon God's mercy and God's grace. Let us now confess the faith that would have held up our sister throughout her life. As we say together the Apostles' Creed, to be found on page 6 of our leaflets. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord.
He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit, and was born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
I invite the congregation now to be seated, as we're now led in prayers, not only for our sister Winifred, but for we who remain, who mourn her passing, who seek the strength and presence of Almighty God.
The intercessory prayer will be taken from the Book of Common Prayer, from air will be used. This begins on page 367 in your Book of Common Prayer. Let us pray. For our sister, Winifred Doreen, let us pray to the Lord Christ who said, I am resurrection and I am life. Lord, you console Martha and Mary in their distress. Draw near to us who mourn for Winifred Doreen and dry the tears of those who weep.
Hear us, Lord.
You wept at the grave of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us in our sorrow.
Hear us, Lord.
You raised the dead to life. Raise our sister to eternal life.
Hear us, Lord.
You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring our sister to the joys of heaven.
Hear us, Lord.
Our sister was washed in baptism and anointed with the Holy Spirit. Give her fellowship with all your saints.
Hear us, Lord.
She was nourished with your body and blood. Grant her a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom.
Hear us, Lord.
Comfort us in our sorrows at the death of our sister. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope.
Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to you our sister Winifred Doreen, who was reborn by water and the Spirit in holy baptism. Grant that her death may recall to us your victory over death and be an occasion for us to renew our trust in your Father's love. Give us, we pray, the faith to follow where you have led the way, where you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit to the ages of ages. Amen. Rest eternal grant unto her, O Lord. May she and all the faithful departed, through the tender mercy of God, rest in peace.
During the singing of the next hymn, collection will be taken.
My spirit cry, Christ my Savior lifted me, now save am I. Love lifted me, when no one but Christ could help, love lifted me. Love lifted me, when no one but
But now the matters.
Christ is risen from the dead, trampling down death by death and giving life to those in the tomb. The Son of Righteousness is gloriously risen, giving light to those who sat in darkness and in the shadow of death. The Lord will guide our feet into the way of peace, having taken away the sin of the world. Christ will open the kingdom of heaven to all who believe in his name, saying, "Come, O blessed of my Father, inherit the kingdom prepared for you." Winifred, Doreen, into paradise may the angels lead you. At your coming, may the martyrs receive you and bring you into the holy city, Jerusalem. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy immortal one, have mercy upon us.
Thank you. God bless you. Good afternoon to all of you. And I welcome you now as we join in the second part of the service of Christian burial for our departed, Winifred Doreen Hinkson. May the Almighty God grant you comfort and peace as we commit her mortal remains back to the earth. Everyone the Father gives to me will come to me. I will never turn away anyone who believes in me. He who raised Jesus Christ from the dead will also give new life to our mortal bodies through his indwelling spirit. My heart, therefore, is glad and my spirit rejoices. My body also shall rest in hope. You will show me the path of life. In your presence there is fullness of joy, and in your right hand are pleasures forevermore. I heard a voice from heaven saying, write this. Happy are the dead who die in the faith of Christ. Henceforth, says the Spirit, they may rest from their labors, for they take with them the record of their deeds. Man born of a woman has but a short time to live. Like a flower, he blossoms and then withers. Like a shadow, he flees and never stays. In the midst of life, we are in death. To whom can we turn for help? But to you, Lord, who are justly angered by our sins. Lord God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, holy and most merciful Savior, deliver us from the bitter pains of eternal death. You know the secrets of our hearts. In your mercy, hear our prayer. Forgive us our sins. And at our last hour, let us not fall away from you. In sure and a certain hope of resurrection to eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ, we commend to Almighty God our sister Winifred Doreen, and we commit her body to the ground, earth to earth, ashes to ashes, and dust to dust. And we beseech you in your infinite goodness to give us grace to live in your dear love and to die in your favor, that when your well-beloved son shall come again in judgment, both this, our sister, Winifred Doreen, and we ourselves may be found acceptable in your sight. Grant this for the sake of your son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Almighty God, with whom still live the spirits of those who die in the Lord, and with whom the souls of the faithful are in joy and felicity, we give you heartfelt thanks for the good examples of all your servants who, having finished their course in faith, now find a rest and a refreshment. May we, with all who have died in the true faith of your holy name, have perfect fulfillment and bliss in your eternal and everlasting glory, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the resurrection and the life, raise us, we humbly pray, from the death of sin to the life of righteousness, that when we depart this life, we may rest in him, and at the resurrection receive that blessing which your well-beloved Son shall then pronounce. Come, you blessed of my Father, receive the kingdom prepared for you from the beginning of the world. Grant this, O merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, our mediator and our redeemer. Amen. Grant, O Lord, to all who are bereaved, the spirit of faith and courage, that you may have the strength to meet the days to come with steadfastness and patience, not sorrowing as those without hope, but in thankful remembrance of God's great goodness and in the joyful expectation of eternal life with those you love. And this we ask in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Rest eternal grant to her, O Lord. May she and all the faithful departed, through the mercies of God, rest in peace. Amen. The Lord bless her and keep her. The Lord make his face to shine upon her and evermore be gracious to her. May the Lord lift up the light of his countenance upon her and give her peace, now and forevermore. Amen. When you look at others with their lands and gold, think that Christ has promised you his wealth untold. Count your many blessings money cannot buy, your reward in heaven, nor your home on earth. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings. See what God has done. The hymn now. When upon life's billows you are tempted, toss.
See what God has done. Count your blessings.
And then one day, I'll cross the river. I'll fight life's final war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory and I'll know he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future and life is worth the living just because he lives. The hymn, God sent his son, they call him Jesus. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Merciful Father and Lord of all life, we praise you that men and women are made in your image and reflect your truth and light. We thank you for the life of your daughter, Winifred, Doreen, for the love and mercy she received from you and showed among us. Above all, we rejoice at your gracious promise to all your servants, living and departed, that we shall rise again at the coming of Christ. And we ask that in due time, we may share with our sister that clearer vision when we shall see your face in the same Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Remember, O Lord, this your servant who has gone before us with the sign of faith and now rests in the sleep of peace. According to your promises, grant to her and to all who rest in Christ refreshment, light, and peace. Through the same Christ, our Lord. Amen. We join and we sing the hymn, sing the wondrous love of Jesus, and to God be the glory as the final tributes are laid. To God be the glory, great things he has done.
To God be the glory, great things he has done. So
The Lord be with you. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God. May the divine assistance remain with us always. And may the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace. Amen. We join now and we sing the final hymn, There is Not a Friend Like the Lowly Jesus. On my own behalf and on behalf of the Twin Parish of St. Joseph with St. Aidan, I take this opportunity to extend to you, family, and friends, our deepest condolences as you mark the passing of Winifred. Be assured. The eternal God is your refuge underneath our His everlasting arms. So may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit Amen. I thank you.
Thank you.
Evening.
Make His face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn.